Hello, everybody. Good evening. Before I go into introducing myself and the speaker, I just would like to point out that we have two fantastic exhibitions downstairs, curated by Paula Meyerink and Forbes Lipschitz. It's been a long week, Forbes, I'm sorry. And I would very much like it if you could join us for the opening after the lecture. So after this infomercial, my name is Dorothée Imbert, and as the head of landscape architecture at the Knowlton School, it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Shane Coen. As several of you know, presenting the breadth of currents and themes that characterize landscape architecture through a few lectures a year is a challenge, and we seek a balance in experiences, approaches, and geographies. Tonight's speaker has led the firm of Coen and Partners for over 20 years, has a long list of distinguished accomplishments and awards. He was a recipient of the Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian, won several national ASLA design awards, and the firm's work was published in Metropolis, Dwell, Architectural Records, and the New York Times. Shane has taught at the GSD and lectured at numerous institutions from Berkeley to RISD. Their list of projects is varied and extensive, from a master plan for a financial district in Riyadh to the diminutive yet exquisite Westminster Presbyterian Church courtyard in Minneapolis. But I would like to point out, apart from the fact that he told me he was the perfect average male to test the Herman Miller Aaron chair, this is a secret, is that he comes to us from Minneapolis. I point that out because our national landscape is greatly dominated by its coasts, and representatives from the North, Midwest, South, and Texas, because that's a particular, its own state, its own region, have to be particularly vocal to have their voices heard, and I think that's what Shane is doing. As a design school situated in Ohio, we can relate. In an age of global concerns and environmental pressures, it is all the more essential to situate our practices. We define our design identity through a regional lens to claim a conceptual position and a geographic territory within landscape architecture, and in our case, landscape architecture education. In a similar way, Coen and Partners has defined a practice that tests timeless ideals within the landscape of Minnesota. Over a century ago, and this is a little wink at my history students, Jens Jensen, Willem Miller, and O.C. Simons argued for the prairie spirit, a loosely defined philosophy that distanced itself from the East Coast landscape canon. Evoking the horizontal lines of the prairie and the modesty of its vegetation, they at once promoted the preservation of this landscape and marked the professional territory. Looking at the work of Shane Coen, one cannot help notice the singularity of design, such as the residential development of Jackson Meadow, and I'm not only speaking about the fact that you see a lot of snow in the pictures. You have the expansive horizon and the undulating meadow bounded by woodland that speak of the prairie spirit. But the clustering of houses, the circulation system, and the 75% of the site which are dedicated open space speak to current planning concerns. Shane Coen practices in Minneapolis, a city marked by its park system, fantastic cultural institutions, and a long history of civic investment in natural resources. In this period of performative landscapes, rain gardens, and bioswales, Coen's contextual minimalism sounds extraneous and timeless. To us, as Midwesterners receiving another Midwesterner, it will seem familiar and at the same time unusual. Please join me in welcoming Shane Coen.
I always feel gratitude, huge gratitude, when I'm, you know, invited to speak to an amazing group of people. And so it's humble to be here. And hopefully I can be inspiring as well. You're certainly inspiring me right now. I had a really amazing childhood. My father was an artist, and I was surrounded in his creations. And it started out in the 60s where he was painting space, and he was teaching art. And he taught me, by the time I reached high school, that he could do a complete 180. So he was immersed in space, and he started then returning to his home, and he started painting his landscape, the landscape that he grew up in Lamar, Colorado, something that was very dear to his heart. And he taught me, whenever we traveled down to Lamar, which was on the Kansas border, to look at things. He used to always say to me, "What do you see?" In the landscape? And what do you see in the cow? Then he switched again, and he started painting at huge scale the people that harvest our food, the immigrants that harvest our food and put it in our grocery stores. And that's on exhibition right now throughout the United States. This is where it launched in Phoenix. There's 15 massive paintings. But it was such a gift to grow up in this environment, and I also grew up in an incredibly loving environment from my mom, who's walking through that space right there. And then I landed in Minneapolis, and I met this woman who I'm married to, who was the first person that I ever met that when she walked into a room that was poorly designed, she was physically affected instantly by the space. She had to get out of the space. And it also taught me to look at landscapes in a new way. And Kat and I have a really interesting relationship. You never see her name in any of our projects, but she's very influential in many of them in our discussions at home. Then I had such an unbelievable break. I was straight out of school. I didn't have any money. I had about $1,000 to my name. I had no experience, and I met a guy named John Stumpf. His dad, Bill Stumpf, designed that chair, the Aeron chair. John was starting a practice, and he was a real introvert, and he was looking for a partner, and we just hit it off. And he said, "Shane, would you open this practice with me?" And I said, "John, I have no experience and no money." And he said, "I just have a feeling about us. I think we can do this. And my dad is giving us rent-free for 5 years, which was huge. And he's also supplying all of our computers, and we can share his office manager, and we can launch with nothing." And so we did. We launched. We launched with a postcard. That postcard won a national award. And we found it on a few very simple principles that were about context, and they were about minimalism, and they were about architecture. We vowed to only work with architects that valued our work and the work, and we loved their work. And so we started. And so the principles of the firm are always context. The project's got to be completely different if you're in Minnesota, or if you're in Ohio, or if you're in Maine. It's always about collaboration. If I say the word "I" tonight, it's not true. I have an amazing team behind me at all times that are developing every idea that ever comes through our office. And it doesn't matter who on the team comes up with the idea, or the client, or the city that we work in. I have a strict belief that you cannot compete with Mother Earth's lines, and I've never tried. I believe we are here to celebrate her lines by contrasting them with very strong geometry. And culture. I love my firm. It's amazing. It's an amazing group of people, and so we love working together. So I ask you, you know, who taught you how to see? And who are you teaching to see? Right? Because it's really our job to look at things in a different way, to create them in a different way, and then to teach people to see. Because it's very interesting, a large percentage of the population walks around and they're not really seeing. Some of us are born and we're just visual, but there's not that many. A lot of us have to be taught. And so, you know, I encourage everybody to think about that and to do that, to take the time to really look at something and know why you love it. It's never quite what you think it's going to be. I love this ashram, because the philosophy of all of the architecture is sharing a commonality, and it's sharing form, and it's sharing color. And what's happening is nature is then coming alive around it. Your eye goes to the nature, and it's really a single composition. And it was that idea that we took to the first development project we ever did, which sits in a prairie in Marine on St. Croix, and I've lived here for 15 years. And we did something in the very beginning when we started studying the land and all the houses in the town. This is the birthplace of Minnesota. We're on the National Historic Registry. And we said, let's paint all the houses white. And everybody thought we were insane. But it's actually been done over and over again throughout history, right? We always return to these ideas. And there was a set of architectural guidelines that were so brilliant, created by David Samala, who did all the houses, and my firm places all the houses, and we did all the planning, which is no house can be wider than 24 feet. You have to have a detached garage. The reason you have to have a detached garage is you want light coming in from all sides of your house, and whenever you look out, you want to be connected to nature, and you can create space with the house and the garage. All roofs have to be 12-12 standing metal seam. Your house has to be placed by us in respect to the house that was in front of you. So there's a composition that starts to happen based upon the people that are already there and the views that were there. The planning principles are really simple and old as well, which is you build on the worst land and you preserve the rest of it, and we put 75% of it into permanent conservation easements. But it's a beautiful story about a prairie and a set of woodlands and a community. And one thing that's really cool that happened when people move in and they share values, environmental values, architectural values, artistic values, we got all ages of people, but everybody was bound by these principles, and so there was a community right out of the gate, you know, which was super important. There's nothing I love more than positioning a piece of architecture on a land. It's very deliberate. It's down to the millimeter. Right, and so you're spacing these. You're placing this on a piece of land, and then here you see the power of a simple line, right? The power of geometry, of placing a structure, striking a line to the front door. We've never planted anything at the base of our structures. We believe in celebrating the horizontal with the vertical, and always having the geometry of the landscape reverberating the geometry of the architecture, so that you're creating a singular statement. And you're planting with broad brushes of monocultures, and in this case, prairie. We had a set of guidelines that you couldn't plant anything back into this development that wasn't already growing there. And so you take the little blue stem from the prairie and you just create a simple garden with it, and it becomes contextual. It becomes part of the prairie instead of independent from it. And here you see a pergola, actually a lawn. We tried to minimize lawns. It's the same width as the house. So it's a 22-foot wide house, 22-foot wide lawn, and 12-foot plinth. And then a pergola with the pickets on the underside. So what I love about placing buildings on structure is then you can move all around them, and then you put the landscape to the outside, so you're always looking at it. So really, you know, kind of simple principles. It's about using the architecture to frame views and spaces that you move through and experience the land in a completely different way. You don't always have to be practical. We pulled this pergola off the path because it seemed like a fun thing to do. You don't walk under it. It's just framing a view from the house out to the community. But the white was the most important decision we did, because if we wouldn't have painted everything white, nature really wouldn't have been the dominant in the landscape. So it's really kind of a beautiful experiment. I love it. I still live here. And I've raised two kids here. This is my son when we first moved in one of the ponds that he was hunting for crawdads. And my daughter walking down a path. So what's amazing when we have a tremendous responsibility when we walk upon a land. This was what it looked like when I first walked upon there, in this kind of overgrown pastures. And see that tree line? The site will always tell you what to do. If you go on site and listen to it, it will always tell you what to do. If you try to design it in your office, it's not going to speak to you. And so that tree line told us that it was the organizational line of the entire project. We would design the community along that line. That was the north-south line that organized the farm. This large hill told us to organize the circulation system around it so we could put the road at the lower elevation and you wouldn't see it. Of course, we would protect the woods. Of course, we would protect the rolling hills. And of course, we would protect the native meadows. The town also told us what to do. When we went to the first town planning commission, we didn't present our ideas, we presented their town. They had never thought about their town like this, most people, right? Look, all the architecture on the National Historic Registry is white. Your roads are only 22 feet wide maximum. They range between 16 and 22 feet. Your houses are typically about 15 feet from the road. They can be 7 feet from the road. The garages are detached. And it's what makes your town so charming. And the trick was they just spent all this money rewriting their code, and it was all wrong. Some engineers came and wrote a code that was about suburbia. It wasn't about protecting this village. And so we had to say to them, we love your town. We want to create a modern day emulation of it. We want to work together. And your code's all wrong. And so, you know, the first meetings were contentious because there was somebody coming into town to develop the largest piece of land that was left in their town. The population 800, right? Somebody's coming in to put another 200 people in there. That's going to raise a lot of eyebrows. So these are the prototypes that David designed quickly. Every house is custom designed. This is a collection of them. If you don't know David Samula, look him up. He's only about a 3-4 person architecture firm in Duluth, Minnesota. His work is brilliant. There's 2 books out. We've done 50 projects with him, counting this as one. And the whole town grew on a grid, and then when it hit the river, it broke. And so we took that concept, that organizational concept, up on top, and we organized the lot line around that north-south tree line, and then the roads as it went out into the landscape, it broke down the same way as the river did. So that was Jackson Meadow. What was so cool about it was we didn't even know it was all instinctual. We weren't looking at any precedents or anything like that. It was just like, this is how we think we should do it. I was super young. We had no idea what we were doing. And David and John and I instinctually, you know, created something that was cool and that lives on. But we held to our principles. Everyone tried to talk us out of it. I had 2 professors from the U come bursting through my doors telling me I was doing it all wrong. That we had to have alleys. I had countless real estate agents tell us we couldn't have detached garages. And I had countless real estate agents tell me we couldn't paint all the houses white. So we held. We believed in it, we held, and it was fun. So that ended, and I haven't showed this project in a long time, but it's relevant again because people are starting to move from the cities out again. The movement is still to move to the cities, right? But back then, people were moving out to the country. And so after we got that project, the Mayos in Rochester, Minnesota, who had always developed land rather poorly, came to us and said, we want to do a legacy project. We want to do something like Jackson Meadow, but you know, our own. And the land was flat as could be. And so we looked at the context of the town, right? So in 1890, of course, it was a grid. It was a very straightforward city. By the time we got to 1950, you see the first little hints at dendritic street patterns, right? The first little hints of suburbia. And then by the time we get to 1980, you see that suburbia surrounded the grid. It's wiped it away. The yellow dot is our farm. And then it started to move out and take over. So when we went there, we loved the land. The sky was kind of immense. There was an interesting collection of hardwoods. The Zumbro River was down below. And the sunsets were spectacular. And this is what it looked like. There was a field that had always been farmed east and west. And then there was a prairie. And then there was all these sinkholes, geological sinkholes. Those are the circles. And then the developer said, the family said, oh yeah, we've already got it approved and you can't go back to the city. So this is the lots. This is the road plan and this is the lot plan. And we just cringed, right? I mean, it was, if you look at it and study it, you see that a civil engineer tried to create a connected system of open space. But it was suburbia, right? It was every house turning its back on its neighbor, clustered and focused on a cul-de-sac. And so we almost said no. And then the office said, no, let's do it. Let's see what we can do with this thing. So we said, okay, step one, erase the lot lines. Plant the entire thing in a field of corn, because it was a farm. Not literally corn, but something that was like corn. So 6 foot, big blue stem over the whole thing. Step two, create cutouts for the lots that don't have anything to do with the lot lines. And they have to go north, south, east, west, so they are emulating the section lines of the farm, and they are speaking to the path of the sun. Started to get kind of interesting. Step three, plant 3,000 red pines and straight lines. Completely ignore the street pattern. Create pedestrian paths along the pines so that people are walking along the pines and not the roads. Now it really got interesting, right? The whole thing was changing. The whole thing was becoming this really interesting juxtaposition. And then we had these fence lines as well that went east and west. And when you put it all together, we did the final move, which was all architecture had to be east-west as well. So all the houses had to be placed and oriented east-west so they related to each other and not the cul-de-sac. In the woods, there was these geological karst developments. They were circular, so we made the lot circular. It's one of the few times I've used circles in my life. And I love these studies because if you take a look at this typical cul-de-sac pattern that happens everywhere, right, where every house turns its back on its neighbor, every house is somehow paying homage to the cul-de-sac instead of the sun or instead of each other, to just a very simple evolution, you know, of what that could be. So it was a super exciting thing. It got a lot of recognition. We were the third landscape architects to ever win a Progressive Architecture Award in the history, which was really, you know, exciting. I was super young at the time. And then it started touring museums. I went to the Walker, the Carnegie, and around the country in an exhibit called Worlds Away. So it was really great. I learned another lesson is the family was divided. And we started the project and they were divided and there was a lawsuit in the middle of it and they were completely freaked out about doing something that made the New York Times. And so there was a lawsuit in the family and the whole project broke. So we only got to build about three homes. But I thought it was worth showing because it's so relevant on as we're thinking about developing land, right? Okay, we're going down in scale. What I really love about residential design, and my firm loves it too. People that join our firm don't think they're going to like it and then just end up like begging for it every couple years, is multiple fold. One, you have a very intimate relationship with the client. And it's, you know, you're designing, you're affecting their lives every day. And so there's a friendship that builds that's pretty serious. But the second one is it's a scale that's very digestible that I think we miss in a lot of schools today. It's a scale of spatial sequencing and materiality that is down to get where you're thinking about every square inch. And then that can translate into larger projects. So in this project, as you can see, is what I was talking about. Of course, the geometry is reverberating out from the architecture, and it's a series of simple moves that create spaces and corridors. This is what it looked like when we drove up. And you know, I had this kind of terrible circular drive, which is this famous suburban move. And it's completely distracting from the architecture. So the first thing we did is we said, okay, let's just ground this house. Pull out a wall and place it in front, take the front door and extend it out to the street, move the driveway over to the garage, and plant a bosque of birch. Those simple moves of two walls set up a front yard sequence that made sense and started to celebrate the architecture. When you move around to the back, there's a subtle practice of color here that's similar to Jackson Meadow, where you move across a bosque of just crushed aggregate, and that oak tree that you see here, which you barely notice here when we went to the backyard, all of a sudden comes to life when you distill down a set of materials and a set of geometry that is in complementary form to the architecture. Right? So it's just a very simple thing, a plane of wood, a plane of white pavers, a field of barberry, and saving that oak tree, and then a sequencing of spaces. So these principles, I think in our profession, we have a real tendency to over-design. And so this is also a really cool project about collaboration with a metal worker, Sebastian, who helped us design this Corten fence, which was we couldn't design a fence taller than 6 feet if it was on the property line, so we pulled it over and created a sculpture away from the property line that totally met code. Now this won a national design award, and I think it's really for its simplicity. You know, I think the concrete pavers and the concrete wall and the white pool creates a sequence of materials and forms that very much brings nature to life. And so what we do doesn't doesn't ever have to be complicated. It actually can be very simple. And in its simplicity, things come to life. And they come to life in the winter as well. I actually love this project in the winter for its kind of stark contrast to the snow. Another project, this we just finished this in Beverly Hills, has that same principles. I wanted to talk about this principle a little bit repeatedly, right? It's this idea that the house and the architecture will tell you what to do when you're working with a piece of architecture. So here there was a break between the garage and the house, a very simple line that went to the back door that created a space that in this case became a pool. The master bedroom was at the top of the screen, so another garden that became the master bedroom, and then a space in the middle for the kids to play. Super simple. But if you start with simple studies and you work them, and you think about a sequencing in the front, it's Beverly Hills. So you're layering in from the street and creating privacy. And in our office, we test and test and test. We start with a simple idea, and then we test the ideas in Rhino until we get to a point with the client and ourselves that we're satisfied. Now, in the backyard, the master bedroom garden we thought wanted to be, the client loved ancient olives. And so we started to test the idea that there would be a very sculptural grouping of olives and a water bench and an art installation at the back. And perhaps the wall would be stainless steel, or perhaps it would be the hedge would wrap, or perhaps it would be a white plaster wall, which is actually where we ended up. But it's so fun to test these ideas, right? We're so lucky that we work in a profession where we can visualize now, and we can take an idea and we can just start to just tweak it a little bit until we get to the proportions of a garden or a pool to a point that we're excited about and the client is excited about. For the pool, we wanted to create a pool that just kind of disappeared, and the elevation of the water was the same elevation as the surroundings. So here you just see the simple principles of geometry and the simplicity of colors and forms. And as you look across the water, the fact that it's at the same elevation as the pool, it becomes much less about the water actually, and it's about a plane. This water wall is made out of black granite. It's elevated about an inch and a half from the ground, and then half of it's water and half of it's dry to sit on. I searched the countryside for these olives and found them from this farmer. He was out of his mind. It was very difficult to work with, but we got them, and we got them to the site and craned them in, and they ended up just being kind of these magnificent children of the property. The water creates a kind of fascinating reflection. This just got installed, so I've been a little obsessed with it. So, those simple principles. This geometry really comes to life here in the way that the house, you know, sits in the field. So, the last residence I'll show you is my first desert landscape, and it is fun. If you get a chance to work with cactus, just take out all stops, because you can do anything with these plants. And so it's super, super fun. Now, I've only drawn a couple curves in my life in 25 years. I just don't believe in recreating nature. I believe that our lines should be very deliberate. But if a piece of architecture is curved, then I will extend a curve out into the landscape, which was the case here, but most of it was angular. So, you know, I went down there and toured the Desert Botanical Garden that Christy Van Eck designed, the entry piece. It's gorgeous. If you go to Scottsdale or Phoenix, go visit it. And really became with the client. And we just went and they picked out all the plants and desert plants that they loved and we loved. Then we collected all the plants when they dug the house, and we kept them on site. And then we reinstalled them in a series of installations. The one on the left here was all recycled cordon cactus from the site. So as you come up in, you're greeted by an installation, an abstraction of the way you would ever find cactus growing in nature, right? And they're arranged by height. That on the right is a group of toothpick cactus. I used to say, if you want 5 plants, you have to have 5 acres, using like 1 plant per acre, and that was a joke. But I do believe in monocultures, and taking a singular plant and celebrating it through repeated use is a really beautiful way to celebrate its form. And so here, each line of the architecture and the geometry is reinforced by a new type of cactus or a repeated form of cactus. And the house was layered, and so we also designed a planter that would bring the trees up on top of the house to minimize its impact on the hill. The siting of this house horizontally and vertically was super important because the house was huge and we didn't want it to dominate the hillside. And so we worked hard with back and forth with the architect, and that's our job, landscape architects. I know we have a lot of architects in the room, and it's your job for us to collaborate on the height and the elevation of these, the finished floor elevation of these houses. So these toothpick cactus really create a fun and unexpected geometry. I think there are 11 inches on center or something crazy like that. But they form space and they reinforce the geometry of this home, and what the end result is a composition between architecture, landscape, and context that very much feels like it's a part of Scottsdale, but it's not trying to be natural. It's very, very much making a statement that we're artists. We're painting with the earth. We're painting with cactus. We're painting with grading. We're painting with paving. I love those silver torch. This is a bed of rosemary. And the pool, again, was designed to be at the same elevation as the surface. And it's really important here that the simplicity of materials, because the more powerful a view, the more simple the landscape should be, in my opinion. So with the pool, it's a giant L that reverberates out from the shape of the architecture. And you see its power when you're looking out at Camelback. So again, I'd say the more powerful the view, the more simple we are. Okay, so we can take those same principles and go up in scale. So we're at the Minneapolis Central Library, and we became fascinated with geology, using geology and installations with this project. And it's the most sustainable story that's ever happened in my career, which was we were working with Cesar Pelli. First time I saw the building, it had all these structural columns. The building was all about the columns. So we took the columns and we extended them out into the urban fabric, and we said every tree and every bench and every light will be placed upon this grid. Now, there was something that happened. Was Caesar wanted a garden around his building, which we never put gardens around buildings. But he was just such an interesting human, and he had a good reason for it. He wanted to protect the glass from the birds, which was a great reason. But they also ran out of money, which was something that as landscape architects we're going to run into over and over and over in our lives, right? And so we got to the end of the project and they were out of money, and I had driven up north many times with my family to go on vacation in Ely, Minnesota, and there was this giant pile of stone, basalt stone, and a huge pile that I always looked at and was like, wow, like look at that abandoned quarry and all that stone that no one ever uses. So we drove up there, we knocked on the door, and we said, how about we use your stone for free? But we'll advertise it, and maybe people will love it. And maybe it'll start getting used again. And that's what happened. So we took this stone and we abstracted what we believed was a fun abstraction of nature, and we started stacking it on top of each other. And we created lots of different mock-ups about this and another abstraction of the Minnesota landscape, which is a birch forest. The first time I ever drove to Duluth, Minnesota, when I moved there from Massachusetts, I was just blown away by the birch forest. So here it's a birch 4 feet on center and a stacked stone, and then the birch turns into a field of lights that we design that are placed upon the structural columns. The birch wrap the building and protect the building from the birds running into the glass. And here you see the stack. There was also a grading issue with the topography of the way it wrapped around the site. So the stone was a way to mitigate the grade and ground the building, actually. So this was an example of a garden that I really liked that was up against a building. It did a lot of work for us. Kids love it. It's absolutely maintenance-free. All the water passes through it. It's collected into a system below and reused for irrigation. And then this bench. This was our first bench that we had ever designed, and it was in 6 or 8 foot segments. Some were 4, and they flipped back and forth, but it had the very simple principles of repetition. So it's an aluminum bench. It's a 3/4 inch member with a 3/4 inch gap. Anytime you take a dimension 2, 2, 2, 2, or 1, 1, 1, 1, or 3/4, 3/4, 3/4, 3/4, and repeat it, you're going to get a mirage, and you're going to get a bench that moves or a structure that moves. And these lights, at the time, there really wasn't any great lights. There's all sorts of great lights being designed right now. So we also designed a very simple aluminum light. And as designers, designing furniture, which I learned from Bill Stumpf, is something that is so fun to do because you get down to, you know, beyond the millimeter, thinking about finish and form. So a very simple project. We brought it in under budget with no money, and it's, I would say, the most maintenance-free project in Minneapolis. This is thinking about going all the way to Singapore. I met Moshe Softy when I was teaching at the GSD, and Moshe had a plan that looked very different than this. It was these two buildings that had all these, as you can see, these balconies that went out, and so the geometry was very much about reaching out and going back and forth. And their site plan had a bunch of kind of curves and moves in it that didn't have anything to do with the architecture. So I sketched a plan with them where every move of the landscape became about the architecture. And so there was a leisure pool and a lap pool, but the cool thing was there was a tight collaboration with the structural engineer and the architect to design the bridges. And so there's a bridge. There's three different bridges on the project. This just got built. We're still getting ready to get better photographs of it. But the first bridge was a landform, so a very simple gesture of land rising up and down with seating on the side. And as you can see, when you're up there, you can look down at the leisure pool that has an island in the middle of it. And then the top is a pool, which when you're up this high, just wood and water, something that simple, creates a rather magnificent view of Singapore. The pergola is the same width as the path. It reaches out to the end of it, and again, you repeat. Right? In this case, the pergola, I think, was 3-1-3-1-3-1 was the repetition. And it creates a beautiful texture. Okay. What happens if you're working in a historic context and you're a modernist? Right? You're going to come across this a lot. I really think our jobs is not to pretend like we're living in the past. It's about living in the present and living in the future and creating timeless landscapes. So we got hired to look at this church, which is the oldest church in Minneapolis, and their wall was falling down, and they wanted to create a space in back of it. It's a limestone wall. And so when they first hired us, they actually just asked us if we would install a picket fence on the top of it, you know, a 4-inch apart black wrought iron fence. And we said, well, you could do that. Or if you're going to do pickets, what if we put them 1 inch apart? 1 inch, 1 inch, 1 inch, and created a more kind of modern texture along the street, but kind of that replicated and paid respect to the old wrought iron fence. But then we went out to the site, and we sat across the street, and we were staring at the church one morning for a couple hours. And they had toured us the church, and they were telling us all about the stained glass windows of the church. Which they really love. They had an amazing collection of stained glass windows. And so I became fixated this morning with our team on the one on the left because they had talked about it and appeared a few other times through the course. And so we went back to the studio and we said, hey, what if we take this idea of the stained glass window and we abstract it somehow? And we either laser cut it or perforate it, and we come up with a pattern that is contextual to the architecture, contextual to the kind of historic history of the church, but somehow it's done in a way that's modern and brings it into a timeless artistic gesture. And so we started looking at, we knew budget was going to be an issue, so we started looking at standardized pieces of metal, which you always need to do, in this case 4x8 copper or 4x8 bronze panels, and that we could either laser cut them or perforate it. We didn't really know. We just drew it up like this and went back to the congregation. And the space up above is higher than 36 inches, so you're going to need a handrail. So part of it would be transparent, and the other part would be attached to a retaining wall that would be retaining the grade. They loved it. The congregation really got excited. And so we got excited about pixelation and perforation. And we started with all different sizes of perforation, just standard sheets, and started filling in the holes to see what sort of pattern we could make. So that's all this is. This is a straight 3-inch, 3/8-inch hole. And then you fill in the holes, and then you create a new punch that you could punch pieces of copper or pieces of bronze. And we tested endless amounts of these in our office. But it became really cool. But when you're doing something like this, you never really know if it's going to work, right? So you think it's pretty cool, you're doing mock-ups, and then you get to the point where you get to go to a metal fabricator's and actually create a few of these things. But they were way shinier than we thought they would be. We decided upon copper. The fenestration of the windows are aged copper. And we started testing them, and we took them outside, and they became, you know, super transparent. And we weren't quite sure if we had it right. And so we made a decision to make the back of it straight perf. If you put the back of it in the straight perforation and the front in the pattern, our theory was it would become more abstract, but also a little stronger. And so we held it up, and it still was kind of impossible to see what it was going to feel like in the street. And so there becomes a time as designers, and it's one of the most exciting things that we get to do, where we just go for it, right? We get it as close as we can, and we start building it. So we started to construct it. As you can see, there's a straight perf on the end and the pattern on the front. And then when we first got it in, it was rather beautiful, even though it was shiny. It was way shinier than we thought it would be. But it had this kind of subtlety to it. You didn't necessarily recognize the stained glass pattern of it until somebody talked to you about it, but it provided a storyline for the church that was very contextual. So by putting the straight perf on the sides and on the back side, you can see when you're inside, it's completely different than when you're outside. And when you're at an angle, the fence moves. So when you're walking down the street, the fence is always moving in front of you. It's doing circles. And then after only one winter, it turned like this, which was we were so excited about, because then it matched the windows. And it became even more subtle. When you walk up at an angle, you can't tell there's a pattern there at all. I like it from the inside more than the outside, because when you're looking for through the straight perf, there's just a little bit more delicacy to it. This is a bench. We tried, up until a few years ago, we always designed all of our own benches. We still design probably about 80% of them, but we also like to celebrate our friends that are designing great benches out there. Inspect some of theirs sometimes. There's a simple water rill. So this is just wire cut brick to give it an old feeling, a simple runnel, a bench, and a fence. All right, one more project. It's a big one. So up until this time, the biggest project we'd ever designed was 370 acres, which was Jackson Meadow. So it was our first project, was one of our biggest projects. And one of the cool things about getting invited all over the country is you're gonna get invited to do stuff that no one's ever going to ask you to do here, because it's just crazy in some countries, particularly in Saudi Arabia has no urban public realm. They have none. They drive. They don't walk. And they have no innovative parks, and they don't have anything like that. So we got asked to go over there. We said no. Initially, we didn't think we wanted to chase a big project in Saudi Arabia. They sent us another letter that said, no, the prince saw your work in a book and wants you to come over and be one of three teams competing for this project. So we went over and took a look at it. And Riyadh's in the kind of central, northern central of Saudi Arabia. This is in Riyadh. I was kind of blown away. We got there, they were just installing a robotically engineered transit system. So five lines in the city, all ending up at the King Abdullah Financial District, which was, the project was to design 1,200 acres surrounding this new King Abdullah Financial District. This is King Abdullah Financial District in the middle, and our site is around it. So this is Riyadh, 1,220 acres with 380 there, and here's Millennium Park, right? So this is huge. And so what they asked us to do was to design a park that would be used by everyone and to increase the population by 80,000 people that would live around the financial district. So to come up with an architectural strategy and an open space strategy that would change Riyadh and create the first public realm. So we started driving around, and here's all the towers that they've been building by many famous architects. And as you can see, there's no public realm. The sidewalks are literally 3 feet with lights and trees coming out of them. People literally don't walk. This site is the site of what we identified as the park. It's a mile long. It's absolutely fascinating to walk along because they're building all these giant buildings. There's an eight-lane highway that separates you from the Kingham to the Financial District, which was really designed more as an island. And so that was one of the other missions, was to not make it feel like an island, but actually take it out and make it feel like part of a new city. There's a lot of beautiful buildings. There's a lot of really amazing architects that have worked here. And, you know, we became enamored. We started studying the context. We went back to the office and we started studying the sun. The sun is intense. It's not that different than Phoenix. It's very, very, very hot. The patterns of the old city are really, really interesting because they all kind of turn to protect people from the sun compared to the new grid that was laid over. And so this kind of juxtaposition between old and new became something that we were quite fascinated with. There was wadis. There was a lot of water, a lot more water than we thought. About 60% of their water comes from underground. And it comes down these wadis and these ravines and is collected in the Wadi Hanif. They just finished this very large project to restore this with Burl Happold and turn it into the first rural park system. People had this fascination. You see their culture goes out into the desert, they lay down a blanket and they drink tea and they connect with nature. But when you go into the city, there's no nature. There's no desert, which was very interesting to us. The sand dunes, though, blew us away. I mean, it really became an incredible fascination and study of ours, but the breakthrough is finding these star-shaped sand dunes. So off the Arabic Sea in Saudi Arabia has the largest concentration of star-shaped sand dunes of anywhere in the world. I didn't even know a star-shaped sand dune existed. And they're amazing. You can see them all down here in the lower left. And we didn't know what we wanted to do with them, but we felt like there would be something powerful to do with them if we kept working on it. Anybody that works in the Middle East, in addition to being, becomes very fascinated with the patterns of metal and perforation and the textures and the shadow that they throw down is, I mean, you're just in heaven over there thinking about these patterns. It's much more rich than what we find here. Numbers are important. And then architecture as a spectacle. I actually hadn't seen a collection of 50 towers quite as powerful as this. And so we really wanted to celebrate architecture as something that people would want to look at when they came to the park system. Zaha Hadid was designing the metro station in front of the towers, which is still getting built, even though she's left us. And so I'm just going to show you the park. The project's too immense. So it's about a mile and a quarter long in the purple. Okay, and the as you can see, there's an eight-lane highway. This is what a private developer owned this land, and he could build this. And so the government asked us to convince him to do it in a way that was kind of good for the people and part of a bigger plan. So he could build this, and if he built this, when you drove down Olaya, which is the big street to the right, you would never see the King Abdullah Financial District. So we said, okay, what if you took the idea of a village horizontally, and you just tipped it up on the end. And we started collaborating with some architecture friends of ours, Shubin and Donaldson, on a plan that for a singular building that would be a mile long, 40 stories tall. And by concentrating all the development along that edge, you would free up all the land for the park. So we get 40,000 people in that building. Now, it would have to be an awfully cool building to be humane, so we figured out many ways that transit would run through it and everything. But the whole idea here was to create this park in between that urban edge, that architectural edge, and the King Abdullah Financial District, and then we needed to make it very contextual, right? So the first thing was water. We had all this water being used inside the King Abdullah Financial District that no one was using. So we started doing calculations with Arup on how we would take all that water and reuse it for our irrigation system, as well as an open water system 3 inches deep running through the whole thing. So we started with the wadi. We abstracted the form of what a wadi would look like and made it angular, so we were very intentional about its form. Then the city just tells you what to do. You just take the grid of the city and bring it right into the park to create your circulation system. So the pathway system, you grab from the city and you pull it in, and you now you've got a wadi and you've got a grid. Then came our star-shaped sand dune abstraction. It's you have to cover 50% of the park by structure there, because that's a requirement. And so all structures that we started to design just looked ridiculous. And so we started working on some structures that were three blocks, 1,200 feet across, with Guy Nortenson, my favorite structural engineer out of New York. So they would go 600 feet up, 600 feet down. And then the first desert botanical garden and a bridge across to Zaha's station all of a sudden created an urban context. So I'm not going to explain these. I'm just going to go through these. And then we can talk. Because I think one of the most amazing things that that it's such a gift. I can't tell you how many times I wake up and just realize that we get to create. But we get to collaborate. Right, and it's never with anybody. So in this particular situation, we had this brilliant structural engineer, we had a team of architects working on the building, we had everybody working on these stars, and we had our whole office collaborating on this park. And so the idea, and we had a very short time frame. And so we just started to kind of work that idea. Of course, it always starts out with a sketch, or in this case, it started out with a vision when I was meditating one morning about these stars. And for some reason, in the middle of my Kundalini yoga, I saw five stars and said, Kat, I think we should do, my wife, these giant stars. And then she said, I think they should be perforated metal. And so that's how it all kind of started. It's like the scale of them became something that was so incredibly iconic, and you start to think about the size of the people kind of walking under them and gathering around them and seeing the architecture through them, a place to sit in the desert and have tea. And so it was kind of an incredible collaboration, an incredible evolution. The High Commission ended up passing it as law. I didn't even know they could do that to a design, but they made the design law. And all of our zoning ordinances, which we didn't even know they were our final recommendations. So you have to be careful. We're powerful. We're creating zoning recommendations. All of a sudden, they became law. And now Saudi Arabia is at war with Yemen, and they have a moratorium on all new development for 2017. So. We're advancing some smaller steps and looking towards 2018. So it's, when I really think about landscape architecture today, you have these themes, right? You have environmental and resiliency, kind of, preventing disasters and disaster relief. That's a huge theme that we're just going to hear more and more about, right? So is social, designing for people and across cultures and in our cities. And so, the march on Washington was just the beginning, right? I mean, I think as designers, we have to recognize that our power is to bring people together, and all types of people. And I I know I have a lot of faith in the young people today. And it doesn't matter if you're, you know, Republican or Democrat, we need both voices saying we love people. And we're going to design for people. And that is a theme that you're going to hear over and over and over again. The more we're investing into our in the poor places in our cities, and we're improving the well-being, it's really kind of incredible the statistics that's coming out about that. So when you go out, make sure you find a firm that has a sound vision, values, and ground rules. Find a firm that believes in the team that's working. Definitely find a firm that's doing good work, but find a firm that is rooted in principles of collaboration and a vision, a well-defined vision on where they're going, and a clear set of values that you can relate to. Because it's a big, you know, this profession is not easy. I mean, I've been working, I'm not gonna lie, it's not everyone in my firm, of course, but I mean, I've worked for many, many hours for 20 years straight, and I love it. But not everybody wants to work those kind of long hours, but no matter what, it's hard. So find a firm you love, and don't forget to teach people to see. Right? And don't forget to take the time to see and create things that you never imagined that you would create. So thank you so much for your energy and time and everything else. Yeah. Yeah. That was the built project or the last one? Oh, that was in Singapore. Yeah. So that's a project with Moshe Safdi, who we're working on a few projects with. We're just finishing one in Shanghai. It's built. It's all built. Those were built pictures. Yeah, they kind of look like renderings, but yeah, no, those were all built images. I have to say, it's such a gift to travel the world and for work. And it's like anywhere you go, the people are amazing. And I mean, I've had just amazing interactions with the people over there. And you know, we hope that we design that it would be something that pulled people together. When you talk to the young people over there, which you only really get to do on the planes, you know, they really want change. So it's like everywhere, people want change. And we work towards that, and they have a long ways to go, that's for sure. Happy to talk more about that if anybody wants to afterwards. I think your school is amazing. I go to schools all over, and it's very interesting the vibes and energy that you feel when you visit schools or architecture offices. And Dorte is obviously bringing an incredibly talented group here. I didn't get to interact with the architect faculty, but I can tell you that the energy is really high. It's up there with any university that I've visited and lectured at, and I think you guys are in a really great place to learn and collaborate and move forward from. So, yeah.